Hello, I'm Charlotte Gilbride, and I'm the coordinator of the Nancy R. Chandler Lecture Series at COCC Foundation. It's really exciting to be here in person. We have an in-person audience, we have a huge live stream audience, so forgive us with all this tech stuff. We think we have it figured out, so let's hope so. I want to start tonight by sharing COCC's land acknowledgement. COCC would like to acknowledge that the beautiful land our campuses reside on are the original homelands of the Wascow and the Warm Springs people. They ceded this land to the U.S. government in the Treaty of 1855. The Paiute people were forcefully moved to the Warm Springs Indian Reservation starting in 1879. It is also important to note that the Klamath Trail ran through this region to the Great Salado Falls Trading Ground, and the Klamath tribes claim it as their own. Descendants of these original people are thriving members of our community today. We acknowledge and thank the original stewards of this land. So, like I said, it's been a long time since we've had a live audience with a live speaker. So, welcome. Thank you all for being here. Again, we do have a large live stream audience, so hopefully if there's any issues there, we'll hear that from the live stream. And we are also recording the program, so any of you who are registered will receive a link to watch this again in the next several days. So if you have to leave early, or if you weren't able to make it, or you want to watch it again and again and again, you'll have that link. As always, I want to thank the Chandler Lecture Series annual sponsors. They are Maybelle Clark McDonald Fund and the Associated Students of COCC. These two entities have been long-time continued supporters of our program, and their support helps us accomplish our mission of bringing renowned speakers, lecturers, and experts to the region to deliver programming on a diverse range of educational and topical subjects, and that's why we're all here tonight. After Dr. Helms' presentation, we will open up the floor for questions. And actually, she said during her presentation, she may ask if any of you have questions on what she's talking about. So during that time, if you would just speak clearly, Dr. Helms will try to repeat the question so that the live stream audience can hear that question. At the end of the program, we'll open up this audience and the live stream audience for questions. So if you have a question here in this room, just raise your hand and I will quickly get to you with a microphone so our audiences at home can hear. If you're at home, you will use the Q&A feature at the bottom of the screen. You're able to see all the questions that have been submitted. You will be able to like a question that you would like answered. You're also able to comment on questions. So we'll try to get to the questions with the most likes. So hopefully that'll all work. I want to start by introducing Dr. Jill Helms with something unique and pretty awesome. When I was first talking to her about potentially coming to Bend for this program, she talked a lot about finding meaning in our lives and giving back to what you have passion for. As the conversation went on, and she related that to longevity, as the conversation went on, she decided instead of the usual speaking fee that we normally pay our speakers, she would like to donate any of the ticket sales from tonight to COCC Foundation scholarships. Yeah, so just by being here, you're changing someone's life through education, so it's pretty awesome. Dr. Jill Helms is a professor of surgery, a professor in the Department of Surgery at Stanford University. She has published numerous scientific studies, filed several patents, spoke for TEDx, spoke for TEDMed Stanford, among many others. She is currently the Vice Chair of Diversity and Inclusion in the Department of Surgery at Stanford. And in this role, she sees the greatest opportunity for improving healthcare. Her mission is to recruit young people from diverse backgrounds and support them in their pursuit of healthcare careers, and in this way address the persistent inequities that exist to access to healthcare. Her longevity research, we're all so anxious to hear, focuses on understanding why healing slows as we age and how this knowledge can be used to improve our overall health and wellness starting today. A fun fact about Jill, she has been known to ride her horse to work, which is on the Stanford University campus. The Stanford is often called the farm, so it's fitting. She lives at Follow Your Bliss Farm, which is about 5 miles away from Stanford. The name comes from a philosopher, Joseph Campbell, who wrote, "If you follow your bliss, you put yourself on a kind of path that has been there all the while, waiting for you. And the life you ought to be living is the one you are living." She encourages you all to find that path as well. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Jill Helms.
What a privilege to be here. So hello to the remote audience. I have been teaching remotely, and I can tell you right now that seeing a person's face is transformative. So thank you for being here in person. And to those people who are remote, I get it. It's easier to listen to a talk like this in your pajamas with the takeout Chinese in front of you, and you don't have to get dressed up. So I'm glad that we can do both. I'm going to talk to you today about something I think we all care about, and that is aging. Not just aging, but understanding longevity. And I think one of the big things about longevity is that it usually means a decline in how we function. And I want to talk to you about how we can think about that decline as not inevitable. And it's predicated on stem cells. So I'm going to assume that most of you have a passing knowledge about stem cells, but not a detailed knowledge. And so I'm going to impart some of that to you today. But I'm going to begin with a very simple question. How many of you think of yourselves as old? Oh, come on. No. You can't even. If you are like me, old means about 15 years older than whatever you are today. I hold this to be this truth to be self-evident. But the fact is, we are an aging world, and I want you to look at the colors on this world map that give an idea of where people are, what percentage of the population is over 65. And this is what it looks like in 2015, and here's what it looks like in 2050. It's dramatic. So this whole question of longevity and us getting older, this is real. You know, a very short time ago, we didn't live nearly as long, and I want to share some of these data with you. For example, if you were a person in Asia in the 1900s, your life expectancy was 28, right? So that's 1900s. It's not that long ago, 120 years. Here, if you lived in America and in a certain part of the country, your life expectancy was 58. This is in, let's see, what year is that? 1950. That was just yesterday, right? And if you think about today, the life expectancy for somebody in, let's see, what year was it? In 1990 is 74. So how did that happen? How did we go from a lifespan that was under 35? In 100 years, we've doubled our lifespan. So you know the answer, right? It's better healthcare. So I don't mean, when I say healthcare, I don't just mean your access to a primary care physician. I'm talking about groundbreaking technologies like how to have clean water, how to keep wastewater separate from the drinking water, or things like better vaccines, better drugs. I mean, this is a picture of the smallpox vaccine. Most of you don't even remember smallpox. But in medicine, we remember it because it presaged other viruses that we all know about. It's not just that. Technology has really changed how we preserve our youngest lives has undergone a sea change. Our understanding of the physiology of a child, and then new techniques and technologies for keeping those youngest of us alive. Those have been an enormous benefit to the youngest of our society. We also now appreciate better outcomes. Now when you get a hip implant, this gives you another 20 years of hiking on those trails you love so much. So better healthcare underlies this extension of our lifespan. But I want to point out something. It is not equally distributed. And that's something that if you weren't aware of it before 2020, you must be now. This is absolutely the case. So it doesn't matter what side of the political spectrum that you are on, it is absolutely the case that maintaining health is our top priority as human beings. And you only need to know that that is so important when you see what losing health looks like. So today I'm going to talk about health. I'm going to talk about what you can do today. And I'm also going to talk about what's near term in terms of therapies that are actually working, as well as those that are completely bogus and you got to save your money. And I'm also going to talk a little bit about the future. All right, so when you think about, my phone is now beeping. When you think about health, I want you to think about it now like a biologist. And a biologist thinks about health as sort of a balancing act between the formation of new tissue and the removal of old and damaged tissue. This is a balance that is maintained. And when we're young, that balance is really well maintained. Tissues are constantly being turned over. Old tissues are lost, new tissues replace them. What happens when we get older is that this balance is disrupted. And so the rate of new tissue formation is slower than the rate of tissue degeneration. And so we accumulate this damaged tissue. Now, I speak very broadly. I'll speak more specifically in a few minutes. But I want you to keep this image of a teeter-totter in mind. It is that balance that is so critical. So here are a few tissues that turn over constantly. Our gut, blood, skin, hair, all of these turn over continually, and they have to be replaced. How do you get new skin? Where does the new skin come from? And the answer is it comes from stem cells. So I want to understand some of the features of stem cells that make them so integral to maintaining this tissue balance. Okay, so there's only two things you have to remember, and there will be a quiz, yes, there will be a quiz, about stem cells. The first is this, that they can do something called self-renewal. All right, so this is how, remember back in biology, remember when dinosaurs walked the earth and you took that class? So two cells, one cell divides, becomes two cells divide and become four. And this process of cell division happens all the time. It's always happening in your body, especially in those tissues that turn over that I just mentioned. But stem cells, their division is different. And I'm going to try to make this understandable. But in the nutshell, this is what it is, that stem cells can make an exact copy of themselves. So they divide, one cell becomes two, and one of those cells is a replica of the original cell. The other cell is slightly different. That's called a daughter cell, and it will go on to become specialized. But the ability to self-renew, this is key. And the reason it's so important is because the stem cells that you were born with are the ones you have in your body today. That's because they're continually making a copy of themselves. Now, here's another cell that continually makes a copy of itself. What cell is that? What? Cancer. It's a cancer cell, and you get the credit for that. So it is. Here's something fundamental about stem cell research. As we study the stem cell, we understand we're studying the cancer cell too. And some of the greatest advances that have been made in the last 8 to 9 years have come from understanding this balance. What makes a cell a stem cell, and when does it become a cancer cell? Turns out cancer cells have many similarities to stem cells. And by understanding why one doesn't go crazy, where are the breaks, we can make the other one become more like a stem cell. Okay, so that was one property, the ability to self-renew. Here's the second property. They can become any kind of cell. All right, so now I want to tell you, I got to take a step back and say, when I say it can become any kind of cell, I'm talking about a specific kind of stem cell. And those are embryonic stem cells. They can become any kind of cell. Okay, but there's a second kind of stem cell, and it's called the adult stem cell. And the adult stem cell is sort of like a different flavor of stem cell. I'll come back to those. But first, I want to talk about embryonic stem cells, because these are the ones that everybody has a controversy about. All right, so I want to make it as clear as I can, where do we get embryonic stem cells? Well, we get them from embryos, obviously. But this is a human embryo, 60 days old. We cannot get stem cells from this embryo. Now, here's an embryo, 53 days. You cannot get stem cells from that. Here's one, 42 days. Here's a human embryo, 32 days of gestation. Can't get stem cells from these either. I can go back in time. This is us. We looked like this. This is a self-portrait. We look like a calzone at this point. We're folded into a little bit of a burrito kind of shape. Here's one where we're still a pancake at 17 days. No stem cells from an embryo this old. So here's a stem cell. This is us. 5 days after the egg meets the sperm. 5 days. And this is called a blastocyst. It got that name because that means in Greek a berry. It looks like a berry, yeah? So if you take this blastocyst and you cut it in half, this little lump right in the corner, that's where you can get embryonic stem cells from an embryo that's 5 days old, when it's at a blastocyst. And here's why I say that those stem cells can give rise to any kind of cell, because that gives rise to that, right? I mean, it's amazing. It's really amazing. But those stem cells are responsible for every tissue in the human body. Okay, now I go back to the adult stem cells. Remember that the purple ice cream. So adult stem cells can become almost any kind of cell. And in every adult tissue, we have found stem cells. In every adult tissue. For example, here's the gut. This is a scanning electron micrograph of the gut. And you can see it's schematized over here on the right. And the stem cell in the gut resides at the very base of what we call the crypt. It gives rise to all the cells, because it self-renews, gives rise to all those daughter cells that form the lining of the gut. And it does this all the time, all the time. That stem cell is absolutely essential for gut health. When you have colon cancer, it's almost invariably a defect in that stem cell. All right, so here's another example of another tissue, the blood. I told you it turned over all the time. Now, you know red blood cells in the blood, right? But there are a lot of other cell kinds, right? There's a white blood cell, the mast cell, the T cell, all the cells that fight off your immune response, that is in the blood. And all of these cells arise from a single cell, the blood stem cell. We call it the hematopoietic stem cell. That's just a fancy word for the blood stem cell. So the idea of why I say adult stem cells and the purpose of using them is because in all of these tissues, they harbor stem cells. And the idea behind regenerative medicine is that you could use those stem cells in the tissue to activate or improve repair of that tissue through the activation of those stem cells. Okay? So now it's time for a quiz, of course, and it's about stem cell biology, so you should be good at this. And it's going to be about blood. Okay, so you remember the hematopoietic stem cell, right? It can become any kind of cell, and it can self-renew, right? Those are the two features. So these are the kinds of cells that are in the blood: red blood cell, white blood cell, mast cells, etc. When a bone marrow transplant is harvested, well, first of all, do people understand what a bone marrow transplant is for in general? Okay, so the basic idea in 1 minute is that if a person has, say, a blood cancer, the idea is to remove the cancerous cells from that person. Usually that involves radiation or chemotherapy. And then from a closely matched donor, you take a bone marrow aspirate, and that's shown here. And that bone marrow aspirate is then put into the patient who just underwent the chemotherapy radiation to get rid of the cancer cells in the blood. That makes sense? Okay. So what is going on in a bone marrow transplant that makes it work? Why does a bone marrow transplant work? Yes, very close. When they take the aspirate, they include hematopoietic stem cells. Now, bone marrow transplants first were done in 1959. So when people say, oh, stem cell therapies are a long way off, no, they're here today. So a bone marrow transplant was harvested with no idea that the hematopoietic stem cell existed. But when it's put into a patient, that hematopoietic stem cell does what two things? What? It replicates and it gives rise to the other cells, right? All the cells of the blood. So you can imagine how a bone marrow transplant works. So this works really great if you happen to have an identical twin, as is the case here. But what if you don't have an identical twin? Well, now this becomes harder, because now you have to find a bone marrow transplant that the person's immune system won't reject. So enter the umbilical cord stem cell. Now, this was one of the biggest surprises to me 12 years ago when the data started coming in, that cells from an umbilical cord, only a fraction of which are from the fetus, this is considered medical waste. After the child is born, the umbilical cord is cut, it's thrown in the trash. Not so fast. It turns out that in the cord, there exist stem cells. Stem cells not from mom, but from the fetus. And if you take those stem cells and you isolate them from the umbilical cord, and then you have to freeze them and you have to store them, that those embryonic stem cells, or I'm sorry, umbilical cord stem cells can be used in a bone marrow transplant to make it work better. Because those stem cells are from a very, very young patient, right at this point, they're like 0 days old, those stem cells are more immune tolerated than they are when they come from an older patient. And so these umbilical cord stem cells are now routinely added to a bone marrow transplant to increase their efficacy. And when you use umbilical cord stem cells, they are very, very young cells, and they're very, very effective. And so this has led to a significant improvement in the engraftment efficiency of bone marrow transplants. Okay, so I'm going to stop there and ask, does anybody have any questions? Yes?
Baby grow into an adult who needs those.
Right. So the question was, is umbilical cord stem cells, are they best suited to the child from which they came or the family members, and can you save them? Yes, you can. In fact, that is the way that most umbilical cord stem cells are saved in the U.S., where a patient, I don't mean patient that way, mom gives birth to the child, and they decide to bank those stem cells. Then you have to pay for those stem cells to be isolated and frozen. They're always at your disposal, but you have to pay. In Europe, it's different. In Europe, every child that's born, their stem cells are collected from the umbilical cord, and they're saved in a bank, like a blood bank, and they're available for everyone, and they're free. They're free of charge. This is not a charge. It's an opt-out program, meaning everybody's signed up. If you don't want to do it, that's okay, but you have to opt out. And as a result, they have an enormous bank of stem cells for bone marrow transplants, where we have a much, much smaller one, because it's put on the back of the, you know, the individual who says, I will do this, I will pay for this. Now, there are some hospitals now at Stanford, we do it routinely. Everybody has the opportunity to have the the umbilical cord stem cells harvested and stored. But again, it's for the good of everyone. Yes?
Yeah, what kind of factors are you looking for a bone marrow match? And my second question is, could umbilical stem cells ever be just used for a bone marrow transplant?
Right. So how many factors do you need to match? Well, the more factors that we understand, the more we require the matching.
How many factors
do we know about? Yeah, dozens, maybe more. And it becomes increasingly hard because we have a much more diverse population now. So people are intermarried from different ethnic backgrounds. It makes it harder and harder to find matches for those individuals. Whereas umbilical cord stem cells, they are agnostic to the donor. Right.
So do you think there'll ever be a day when you can use umbilical stem cells
alone? The question was, is there ever going to be a day when we just use umbilical cord stem cells? I am sure that that will be the case. I am sure. Because we can expand them as well.
So then you wouldn't have so much rejection.
Right, exactly. No. Yes?
Is legislation being changed right now to have the same type of process here as they do in Europe?
Right. Is legislation being changed so that we have a process like Europe that is opt-out? At a glacial pace, it's changing. Glacial. This is something that people don't think about until you really need that, umbilical cord stem cells. So I would say this is the kind of thing where, you remember once upon a time where it was a controversy whether you become an organ donor? I hope everybody's got that on their driver's license. This should be equivalent to a blood bank. You go, you give blood, and it's for the good of all. There should be no distinction. And no more throwing away an umbilical cord in the medical waste. Any other questions? Yes?
Europe, what about Canada? Are they doing anything like this in Canada?
Are they? So the question was, is Canada enlightened? Yes, they are enlightened. Yes, they are. Yes. We're a little slow here, I'll just say that. Okay, one more question, then we'll move on. Yes?
Can you differentiate between renew and regeneration?
Yes, so the question was, can you differentiate between the idea of self-renewal and regeneration? Is that what you're asking? Right. So self-renewal is a phrase that is used to describe a stem cell making a copy of itself. And that self-renewal is a cellular process. The idea of regeneration is the entire restoration of form and function back to its original architecture. So you can imagine that most of what we do when we are injured is not regeneration. We call it repair. Yeah, so that's going to be an interesting and important distinction. So thank you for bringing that up. Okay, I'll keep on moving here. So I promised I'd talk about aging, something that's very near and dear to my heart as I continue to do so. But remember, it's so much better than the alternative, right? Okay, so here's something I want you to keep in mind, and I mentioned it briefly. That is that tissue homeostasis, that means that balance, declines as we age. And now I taught you that adult stem cells make an exact copy of themselves, right? Well, I was a little bit exaggerating because stem cells also age, all right? So they're not perfect. And I'll give you an example. So the stem cells that make our hair a certain color have been identified. This is about 5 years ago now. They're called melanocyte stem cells, and they're shown here, and here's a drawing of what it looks like. And the melanocyte stem cell produces melanin, and this gets worked into the hair shaft, and that's why our hair has a color. And we now know that as we age, this melanocyte stem cell sort of starts to slow down, and that is why our hair turns gray. Now, some of us have figured out ways around this. they have nothing to do with stem cells. Here's another one. Our stem cells in the skin are responsible for producing daughter cells that build collagen. As we age, those stem cells self-renew a little bit slower and slower, so the production of collagen is decreased. That's why we wrinkle. Right, so these things don't sound all that bad, right? I mean, I said tissue homeostasis declines as we age, but here's the other part. So does healing capacity. Now that makes a big difference. Here, for example, this, say a child under 10 sustains a tibial fracture, and a 30-year-old, sustains the same kind of tibial fracture, one will heal in 6 weeks, the other will take 6 months. Why is that? It's because we are aging. So if you're like me, this raises an obvious question. Well, how does our body know that we're aging, right? It's not like it's reading the watch. Well, it turns out our cells are keeping track of time. And this is going to be critical to understanding how and why we age and what we can do about that. So this part's important. So there are two kinds of age. There is chronological age. It's what's on your passport. It's how many candles you have on your cake. That's chronological age. You can pretty much ignore that. The other is biological age. Biological age is the age that your cell thinks it is. And it's only loosely related to chronological age. This is the amazing part. So a cell understands its biological age. Cells together form tissues. Tissues together form organs. Organs form us. So as a cell thinks it's a certain age, that is how the tissue will look. And I'll give you some examples of that. But here's how a cell knows how old it is. It's determined by something called telomeres. And telomeres are these caps that sit on the ends of our chromosome. Okay, so the chromosome, which you all remember, is that collection of our DNA. So all of the DNA that we have in every cell of our body is condensed down into this structure that's colored blue. And on the tips of those chromosomes are a cap. It's like the end of a shoelace that keeps the shoelace from unraveling. It is called a telomere. And I will tell you that the science behind these telomeres is Nobel-winning research. This was a discovery made in the mid-2000s by Elizabeth Blackburn. And understanding the function of these telomeres has been like the critical piece in understanding why we age. So here's a picture of human chromosomes And the telomeres are identified with a kind of immunofluorescence, and they're yellow. And I will give you some of the features of telomeres. The first is, in a young person, telomeres are very, very long. And in an older person, or a person with a disease or certain habits, these telomeres shorten. Every time a cell divides, the chromosome has to separate, and the telomere is shortening every time. So when you expose yourself to certain kinds of toxins in your environment, this accelerates the rate of telomere shortening. This is a choice, right? So this accelerates the rate of telomere shortening, and as a consequence, when the telomere is all the way to the end, then that's the end of life, right? So the longer those telomeres stay, the better. So here's where, you know, when you think, oh, it's going to be a special drug I suggest. No, no, this is life choices that you can make today that have an influence on telomere length. So if you look at two identical twins and you look at how they live their lives, if one is, say, a smoker compared to the other, you will see visible differences in the tissue. The tissues look older. Why? Their biological age is older. Their telomeres are shorter. Right? So this is a measurable phenomenon. This is not, you know, just a pie in the sky. You can obviously see the differences, but now we know why that happens to a tissue. Its biological age is older than their identical twin. Aging is malleable. It's relative. Remember how people say you're only as old as you feel? Well, it turns out it's true. So here's a study that was done a few years ago. It was a very short study. It's now a much bigger study. It's longer now. But this study was so remarkable because it showed that biological age could be reversed. It could be reversed. So that's amazing. These patients were for 12 months studied. They were all healthy. They took a cocktail of three drugs, and in 1 year, their biological age was younger by 2.5 years. That means it's malleable. That means we can do something about the rate of aging. And my guess is you're probably thinking, now, how can I lengthen my telomeres? The key is keeping them from shortening too fast. So I'll give you another thing that shortens telomeres, and this, I think, is pretty remarkable. Stress, right? Did you ever think that stress had any ill effects? Well, here's the data. A study is run. Two groups of women, both of them have children, so that's stressful enough, right? But one of the groups, the children, had learning disabilities. The telomeres of each person was measured at the beginning of the study. 12 months later, the telomeres were measured again. The women in the group with the kids with learning disabilities had significantly shorter telomeres after 12 months than the average of their cohort just with kids. So this was a one-on-one. One person at the beginning of the study, telomeres measured. 12 months later, same person. So this is not a group. This is one person, one measurement. And so this paper was published quite some time ago. I want you to see the middle author there is Elizabeth Blackburn, the person I told you who discovered telomeres. Telomere shortening in response to life stress. All right, so life stress. This is something every day we have a choice about. Right? And when you think about stressful environments, I think this is probably one of the most stressful. It is astronauts in outer space, right? So did any of you see the movie Gravity? Yeah. Do you remember this scene? I think it will play. Remember this?
Yeah.
And she's like, freak me out? Oh, my God. Right. Okay, so it turns out that's a movie. But NASA had two astronauts, identical twins, measured their telomeres. One went up to the space station, the other stayed on Earth, measured their telomeres at the beginning and at the end. And as you can imagine, telomere shortening was accelerated in the more stressful situation. So this, to me, is the kind of data that should let you think about stress in your own lives. And when you think about what can you do about stress, I will tell you the single most important thing you can do is we have the ability to choose one thought over another. So that is in your arsenal of things you can do. Okay, so I'm going to stop. Here's a lot of not science. Okay, so all of these things they have the word telomere on them. Do you notice that? Yes. And here's a telomere enhancing cream, and then you can get stem cells from apples, and it's all baloney. All baloney. Okay, so you can't eat a telomere. All right, so questions. Yes. Yes.
What were the criteria used to measure biological age in that study?
That's a great question. She was asking, in that study where the biological age was shortened so significantly, how did they actually measure biological age? So this is the work of, he used to be at Harvard, but a biostatistician that has done an enormous amount of work on measuring telomere length and aging in general. And through an enormous data set that's available now around the world, he found algorithms that help predict the biological age of an individual's cell. And using these algorithms across multiple kinds of tissue, multiple populations, there is now a well-accepted algorithm that can be used to say, from a certain cell, what are the epigenetic signatures that say the biological age of this individual? And apparently, the accuracy is remarkable. He has now moved from Harvard, and he's now at a startup company in, Los Altos. It's called Altos Labs, and it's funded by a couple of billionaires you might know, Jeff Bezos and, some other ones. So, let me just tell you, that's really, really good science. That is really, really good science. So the ability to measure biological age is very robust now. It's not the kind of, the ones on the internet, get your biological age. It's not that technology. So just FYI. Yes?
You referenced another study where the individuals, and you said all of them took three drugs.
Right.
And it improved.
Yes, what are those three drugs? So the obvious question is, what are those three drugs and where can I buy them? Right. So there are two drugs that are for treating diabetes and another drug that is a growth factor. So now the study is ongoing. It's multi-center. There's thousands of people involved in the study. Let's see what that data look like, and then we're all going to run out and buy those drugs, I guarantee you. Yes, yeah.
I'm just curious what the effect of the telomere size change. Does it really, really, really do the small changes be affected at changing rate or the effect?
So the question is one of magnitude. You want to know how much change before it's worth me getting up from the couch and running or something like that, right? So that the devil's in the details, right? Because they're looking at length of time is usually about a year. And it always has to be the same individual that's measured before and after. Your telomeres and my telomeres are already different lengths. So in that year, it is statistically significant, which does not mean clinically significant. Aha, but it's only 1 year. So if you now add, let's say it's a decade, now that's going to have a measurable impact on a quality of life. So I say, you got to start today, to make the effect that you're going to appreciate sometime down the road. Yes? So the question is, are telomere lengths consistent across populations? Is that it? Across chromosomes? No, they are not consistent across. For example, telomeres in one tissue can be different lengths than telomeres in another tissue. So it's tissue specific as well. So some tissues can age faster than others based on, say, a habit, or drinking too much, things like this, can shorten the telomeres in one organ compared to another. Yeah. One more question, I'll move on. Yeah?
How does heredity factor into all
this? Ah, yes. How does heredity factor into this? What a predictor of lifespan. If you really want to have a good predictor, find out how old your parents were and their parents were at the time of their death. This is probably the biggest component of what we can do about aging. Understanding the genetics of aging is a challenging thing, because what we care about is our aging. But to study our aging is a very slow process, right? You've got to wait generations. So we use animals that age very quickly, and we study them and look for differences in how they age. And there are things like the naked mole rat. Did you know about the naked mole? The naked mole rat is like, compared to a rat, and it looks just like a rat, only uglier, it has a lifespan of 30 years, and a regular rat, has a lifespan of about 3 years. So studying these kinds of animals helps us understand the genetics of aging. Okay, last couple of things here. I wanted to tell you about, I told you about this, it's reversible. Who knew aging could be reversed? This is paradigm shifting. Think about it. This is my father, young, middle-aged, elderly, and what I'm telling you is that age, which always goes this way, is actually reversible. And this, if you think I'm making this up, this is Nobel Prize winning research. This was a Nobel Prize awarded to these two men in 2012. He rocks a great head of hair, you gotta admit. And John Gurdon, Shinya Yamanaka, and they came up with a very important discovery. They came up with the idea and then proved that there was something called an induced pluripotent stem cell, and I'll tell you just briefly how it works. It goes by something called reprogramming. It's only slightly more complicated than this kind of reprogramming. That's how I feel about it. Here's the experiment. An old skin cell was harvested from an individual. This is what the skin looks like. One of those cells, an old cell, was harvested. And then the kind of experiment that is shown here was done. The nucleus of an egg cell, that is a cell at the very beginning of its life, was removed. The nucleus was removed from a skin cell, and the old nucleus from the skin cell was put into this egg cell. And the idea behind it is, if the nucleus still had the information, and that's shown here with these little blue dots flowing around, that it could reprogram this cell and make it into a blastocyst again, if the nucleus contained that information. And John Gurdon said that the information that was contained in the nucleus was so vast that there would be no chance to really understand what were the factors responsible for that reprogramming until. So this is the idea that you could take a single nucleus from a cell and that would have all the information. What Shinya Yamanaka did was he showed that you could do it with four proteins. And he showed that if you injected those four proteins into an egg cell, and that's shown right here, and the needle comes out, that cell, that old cell, could become a young cell again. I know it's hard to believe. So here's the idea. You have stem-like cells. They differentiate into skin cells, old cells. And then what I'm saying is you can make the old cell go back to a stem cell state. You can make that turn around. Now, I know that that just seems like remarkable. It was done first in a couple of labs. Now it's being done in labs around the world. People can do it with all kinds of cells, not just from the skin, from the brain, heart, you name it, any organ. And they can create these induced pluripotent cells. Now it's being done in animals. They have used these stem cells to generate new animals who are younger. But they have a problem. What do you think they develop?
Cancer.
That's right. So that is where that science is right now. But I think it's remarkable because it shows us the potential that age is not a one-way street, but rather it's malleable. We can do something about that. Okay, last chance for questions. Yes? Yeah?
So I was reading many, many years ago about how they were using hormones to freeze or reverse aging. Was that real science or was it foo-foo stuff?
So the idea is that you were reading many years ago that you could use hormones to reverse aging. And if I am thinking about the work that you're talking about, that would not be legit science. Yeah. There's some data that some hormones can affect the aging process, and it's in that study, what are the three drugs? One was a growth factor. But by itself, there's no evidence that a hormone on its own can reverse telomere shortening or anything like that. That's today I say that. Yes, I'll back there.
Okay, so would the reverse aging of a cell be used maybe to focus on a specific disease organ?
That's exactly right.
Not the whole person.
So that's exactly right. So you brought up how would one think about using this knowledge about reversing aging in a cell. And the idea behind it, the therapeutic idea, is let's say we have a patient that has cells that have degenerated and they've led to, say, Alzheimer's. The idea is maybe you could reverse that disease process and revert the cells back to a younger state. They don't necessarily have to be stem-like, but they have to be a younger state. And that maybe that could be a process for treating degenerative diseases. That's the idea. Yes?
Yeah, but if you can treat one little thing, you know kind of where it's going to go. They're going to want to treat everything. And so are they thinking they can beat death?
So the question is, if you give them an inch, they'll take a mile, right? And they will. If you treat one disease, they'll treat many things. Of course, the idea that we could do it in one tissue. If we can do it in one tissue, then why wouldn't we do it in others? The concept of, you know, beating death. Okay, so we're not out to, you know, cure death or achieve immortality. This is much more about healthy living to the end of our days. And I think you bring up an important point, though, in the subtext, which is where does science lead us? And I hope that we can have that discussion at some point, because I think it's a really important one to think about.
Yeah, but I don't think Bezos and the folks who are funding this are thinking about, let's have my liver last a little longer than it's needed.
Right, so the question, well, it wasn't a question, it was a point of view that there are certain billionaires that are probably more interested in preserving their own body. Fair enough. All right, so a lot in the last few minutes, a lot of our information about how we can use research to help improve human life comes from studying animals that are remarkably good at regenerating. Here is a hydra I know it looks like a plant. It's not. It's an animal. And every time you cut off one of its stalks, it will regrow. It will do that for as long as you want to sever the hydra. There's no apparent aging phenotype in these animals. The same is true of axolotls and other animals that can regrow severed limbs. This is a time lapse of a severed and then regenerated limbs. And all of the tissues regenerate, the cartilage, the muscle, the skin. And they do so because there are stem cells in each compartment. So there's the stem now. A little gross, but okay. Then they form this thing called a blastema on the end of the severed limb. And the blastema contains stem cells from all three tissue compartments. And those stem cells, shown here with little floaty dots, are what give rise to the regenerate. And our understanding of regeneration in humans comes from this because of something called conservative evolution. It's the ultimate recycling. Nature has used the same molecules over and over again. And one of the most potent is a protein called WNT. It's spelled W-N-T. And WNT is a potent stem cell activator. And at Stanford, a lot of the work that we're doing centers on this WNT protein as a stem cell activator. And whether we're interested in treating degenerative spine diseases or osteoporosis, whether we're interested in how do tissues heal, here's an injury site that the green cells are stem cells, and here's what it looks like after they get recruited. Here's the tissue. And all of the regenerated tissue comes from the stem cell that are labeled in green. So we know a lot about how these tissues heal. We now know that older stem cells tend to be sluggish as compared to younger stem cells, and we think that by activating old stem cells, we can make them behave like young stem cells. And we do that with this, what looks like a relatively innocuous protein. And this WNT protein has been studied by labs around the world. And here's where I want to make just I want you to think about this for a second. A lot of what we learn about WNT and its role in our bodies has come from a fruit fly, from studying a fruit fly. And so when I hear politicians deride, why are we spending money on fruit fly research? Here's why, because this animal breeds super fast. You know how fast. Put out a banana. See how fast. So these animals have WNT proteins that look just like ours. So using these animals, we can understand the wiring diagram, and then we can develop tools and technologies to produce WNT proteins, and then we can use those to treat diseases like osteoporosis. There's a drug in phase 3 clinical trials. We can also treat childhood cancers, because these are due to mutations in the WNT pathway. So when you hear about that fruit fly research, I just want you to think for a second that, yeah, that's where a lot of our discoveries come from. So these stem cell activators, I told you WNT is a stem cell activator, and we in my lab are making it into a protein therapeutic that is now in clinical trials. And we think that we can activate a whole host of cell types to lead to better healing. But there's no panacea, right? Because if there's too much WNT around, there are side effects. So this is the balance that we... So if you're thinking I'm going to go out and buy me some WNT, no, you're not. So in the interest of time, I think I'm going to leave this for the open session. And I just want to finish with a couple of words about Stanford and maybe the environment. If there are students here who are thinking, maybe you in the back, about coming to Stanford at some point, I want to say that that environment for me is one where I feel like we dwell in possibilities. The idea of what could be is in the drinking water. And I see that here too. And I think that this kind of community college is serving one of the most essential needs, and I'm just so glad to be invited here today to talk with you. It's a huge honor for me. So, of course, I'm going to finish with a little advice. Who doesn't give advice? The first is, I don't know about you, but for me, you know, every day I get a little older, life becomes more beautiful, right? And I think I'm at a place now where I can see that last horizon, and what lies ahead to me is so much more valuable than whatever has come in the past. And, you know, I know that a lot of people want to, you know, cure death, immortality, but I think most of us here are just wanting to retain our health so we can continue to explore and we can continue to learn for the rest of our days. And so I give you a couple of ideas. One is, each day is unrepeatable. Live it to its fullest. Avoid toxins at all costs, whether they're in people or rhetoric. Stay awake from it. Right? I think each of us should invest and alleviate suffering wherever we find it. And if COVID hasn't taught us that communities have suffered disproportionately, you know, it's right there in front of us. And we should think about how we can help every step of the way. Love more. Love this planet and love the people around you. I don't think any day should be considered complete until you've done something for somebody who can't pay you back. And I think that remaining engaged in community colleges like this, this is how you serve your community. It's a great thing to see, and I'm so proud to be asked here to come and speak. And above all else, remember to wear sunscreen. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you. So might people want to leave, or do we just into question and answer? Or
have some questions from the live stream audience.
Okay.
So I have on both my mic so they can hear.
All right.
There's quite a few good ones. One is, can an individual get tested on the algorithm to find out their biological age?
Yes, that can be tested. Yes, it's possible. I think it's quite expensive at present, and I won't give any names of companies or anything because I don't. That's not my line of work. But it is possible to be tested. If that would make you feel more comfortable, I will tell you, do what you can right now. You don't need to be tested. Your mom was right. Do all the things your mom said. And that would be, yeah. But you can get tested. Yeah.
And yeah, if there's somebody here that wants to ask a question, and then we'll do another one from the live stream. Or are we questioned out? Okay. Yeah.
How about you, all the way in the back?
Thanks. You said that hormones did not reverse aging or extend the telomere, but do hormones slow aging?
Do hormones slow aging? There is certainly, yes. Estrogen is probably the best studied of these, that definitely have an impact on tissue health. But in terms of their ability to slow telomere shortening, that I have not seen evidence of. And you can imagine how complicated that experiment is, right? Because you have to have a group of people who are willing to be on estrogen in a very defined format, and you have to eliminate all other variables. So these have to be women who are postmenopausal, then they have an estrogen supplement. And now we already know that some of these things carry risk. So those kinds of experiments are tricky to do, but definitely they do have an effect on tissue homeostasis. Yeah. Yes.
Okay. Oh. I was going to go live stream.
Okay. Yes. Now come here.
Do stem cells have anything to do with mental health, such as depression?
So here's where science is slower. And that is on the things that we can do, like meditation, yoga, massage, things like this. People feel better after, and they oftentimes want to have some evidence that this is having a positive effect. Now, those studies are also very difficult to do. So there's no strong data right now on the role of stem cells in mental wellness and these practices that we know, you know, are beneficial to our bodies. But that doesn't mean that it isn't, it doesn't have a positive effect. We just don't know that yet. Yes?
So you talk about the use of stem cells with diseases like osteoporosis or aging. But what about in people who maybe had a brain injury upon birth, such as like cerebral palsy?
Right.
Could stem cell therapy aid in that somehow?
Yeah, that's a really important question. So the question was, you talked about stem cell therapies and things for maybe some kinds of injuries or diseases, but not others. And maybe the most important are those like birth defects or maybe chronic degenerative diseases. By far and away, those are the targets that people care most about. Parkinson's, Alzheimer's, anything neurological. Those are also the biggest challenge. Because when a person, I'll take spinal cord injuries as an example. When a person suffers a spinal cord injury, the first reaction is inflammation of the tissue. The tissue swells and there's damage caused by the swelling. The damage to the nerves is probably the most detrimental. Then scar tissue forms. And once the scar tissue forms, it's nearly impenetrable, and that's why the neurons can't grow through the scar tissue. And that's why usually when there's an injury to the spinal cord that's severe, that is a permanent paralysis. So the idea is, well, that is the largest population of patients that need help. The idea is you have to catch it early for some kind of stem cell therapy to have a positive effect before the tissue undergoes these degenerative changes. So now, for example, if you want to be in a spinal cord injury study, you have to be within 2 weeks of the injury. So they want the fresh injury, you see, because we still haven't figured out how to get around those degenerative changes. That's true for all of the diseases we care about. All of the diseases we care about are degenerative ones, and we first have to find out how to make it work in the optimal condition and then see how we can deal with the degenerative condition. So that's why, you know, for fractures or for stroke, or for patients who've had a myocardial infarction, the treatment has to happen very early on. Not because that's the highest and best use of our knowledge, but that's the proving ground for subsequent therapies. Yes?
Yes?
I've heard that caloric restriction is associated with longevity, and is that due to its effect on telomere length?
Caloric restriction and its effects on longevity. So the best data on caloric restriction and its effects on longevity come from studies in rodents. There are data that support that caloric restriction and maybe certain kinds of diets or fasting periods can have a positive effect on longevity. But to my knowledge, the effects on telomere length are not known. Yeah. Yes?
So there's a lady out there, Dr. Ellen Langer, and wrote a book, Counterclockwise. Are you familiar with that?
No.
Oh, it's a low-cost study. She took a busload of men from an assisted living center and took them to a monastery.
Okay.
And she kept them there a number of weeks. But before they went there, she had their hearing, their eyes, and their strength tested. And in the monastery, all they could do was look and live like they were in 1955.
And so this had a positive effect or a negative effect?
It had a positive effect.
Okay.
So when they came back,
yeah,
their hearing was better, their eyesight was better, and their strength, grip strength was better, mm-hmm. and they could carry their luggage back into assisted living. So you've never heard of that. I was just thinking whether or not that's bogus.
No, you know, I never discount an anecdotal story. I don't, because it happened to somebody, and if it's recounted accurately, it happened. But I don't judge it with a scientific lens. For me, a scientific study has to have a control group and a treatment group. They have to have well-defined objectives at the beginning of the study, and those have to be measured at the end, and they have to be followed with all the rigor and the ethical limits that we put on studies today. To me, that's a scientific study. And what you described very well may be true. There may be a lot of, you know, maybe if you're living in 1955, you have to get up from your chair and turn the channel on the TV. There's a little exercise, you know. It could be beneficial. So I never discount an anecdote. But I do take it with a grain of salt.
Yeah. Okay, we'll go over to the lab stream.
Okay.
How do longer telomeres affect cell function?
Right. How do longer telomeres? So you might think from all I've said that what you want is super long telomeres. But cancer cells have super long telomeres too. So, as do stem cells. There's no way that I know of today in the scientific literature that shows a way to lengthen telomeres. What you can do is slow down the shortening, right? And so that's what we know about it today.
Okay, great.
Yeah.
And one more. Are PRP injections worth the cost in regenerating cartilage in knees?
Oh, the PRP, oh, so that's platelet-rich plasma, platelet-rich fibrin, et cetera. So has everybody heard about this stuff? Okay, so this is the idea that you can take from a patient some of their blood, you spin it down, you collect certain fractions of that spun down material, and in that fraction are factors that if they were injected into a place where there's injury or damage, would stimulate repair. And there are a lot of studies on this. And the reason why is because it's not regulated by the FDA. So why is it not regulated? Because it comes from you, it goes back into you, and it never leaves the room where you're at. So those are the criteria. Now, does it work? I said there's a lot of data. There's a lot of data. It's equivocal. I see no strong data saying that it works. Now, somebody will say, but I know somebody who got it injected into, and I'm glad for that person, but I go by the data, and the data say it's equivocal. There's no strong data showing that it works. So then people say, well, we need more studies. There are a lot of studies on PRP, and it doesn't look like it worked. Now, would I get it done if I had an injury that wasn't healed? I guess as a last-ditch effort before going to, the surgeon. I'm a surgeon, but but there's no good data that shows that that absolutely works, or if it does, how it works. Yes. 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 Yes, one of them is metformin. Now she's, now you're going to go out and get that. Yeah. Yes.
When you talk about epigenetics,
yes.
You talk about choice. I totally am on board with that. There are a lot of people who don't have as many choices and are more disadvantaged than maybe all of us sitting in this room. And how is the research at Stanford and funded by people we won't mention, how is that going to help people who don't have as much choice
right.
in changing their lifespan?
Right. This is a very good question. How is this research that's being done going to affect or help people whose choices about avoiding a toxin, for example, is much more limited than many of us experience. And here's where I have to ask myself, should I be doing this kind of research, or should I be putting all my efforts into, finding a better toilet, building a better way to sanitize water for people where that's a big problem? And I wrestle with that because there's an enormous amount of money that goes into making these breakthroughs. And whether this is a good reason or not, the way I look at it is when we went to the moon, that was considered an outrageous amount of money to spend on what seemed like a frivolity. But what came out of it is what we today enjoy, called the internet and computers and a lot of other technology. And so what I hope is that through the education of young people from all over, and in my lab, I preferentially choose those who are underrepresented in medicine and in science, that you change that person's life. And by changing that person's life, they will change more, and they will change more. And that there's something about being on the cutting edge that has an effect someday on millions of people. That's what we all hope. I agree with you, though, that, that's a hope. Make me prove it now. So I hear you. Yeah, I think it's an important question. Yes, all the way in the back.
You talked about toxins we should be avoiding, and particularly interested in alcohol, but which in our lifestyle, what should we really be doing?
Well, everything your mommy told you. So we know perfectly well about how diet, what things we should avoid in our diet. High fat, a lot of meat. We know excess of alcohol, any kind of smoking. There's no kind of smoking. There's no kind of nicotine that has any positive effect for you. We also know things like the environment, the air we're breathing. This has a big effect. The water we drink. We know people in Flint, Michigan, right, that couldn't drink what came out of their tap. All of these things are well known. We just sometimes don't internalize what it means to our bodies. I think that's the most important part. Yes, in the back, and then I'm going to show one short video after this. Yeah, that's a great question. What keeps those animals regenerating, like the hydra and the axolotl? Probably one of the best studied is a flatworm called planaria. And this animal, if you divide it in half, the head develops a new tail, the tail develops a new head, and you can do the pupils, chop-o-matic, and they'll all. And we know that regeneration, and that in sponges that also regenerate and in axolotls, depends on that wind protein. So that's a key factor. So we learned about wind from these animals. They use it in a completely regenerative way. That's what we're hoping to mimic. Okay, I hope you'll indulge me as I show you a very short video.
There's more to see than can ever be seen, more to do than can ever be done. There's far too much to take in here, more to find than can ever be found. By the sun rolling high through the sapphire sky, keeps great and small on the endless run, is the circle of life, and it moves us on to this end and hold through faith and love.
Thank you. Thank you.